Welcome back everybody to another video. This time we'll be checking out the Radeon HD-7770, a card that may well be over 10 years old, but may just have a bit of life left within it. Our version here is an Asus dual fan variant that's just a bit souped up from your average card. Releasing back on May 21st, 2012, this card was released under the 28nm GCN1 architecture as a budget mid-ranged option. I couldn't find a specific price anywhere, other than Office Max, which apparently had it listed for about $180. Which seems about right, considering the original 7770 MSRP'd at about $160. Leading on into the specs, we've got our core clock running at a decent 1020MHz, while our memory is at 1150. These are about a 2% gain over stock, which is not much, but it's something. Speaking of our memory, we've got 2 whole GB of GDDR5 memory running on a 128-bit memory bus. We've got some pretty standard video outputs, 2 DVI, 1 HDMI 1.4, and a singular DisplayPort 1.2. This GPU will require a single 6-pin power connector, as it requires 80 watts under full load. This PCIe 3.0 card also has some basic implementations of both DirectX 12 and Vulkan. While it may not be modern implementations, it is very nice to have to play some more modern games. Installing drivers would have been straightforward, but maybe you can notice some small little hiccups every now and then. It's the first time I've ever seen that happen, but at the very least, it didn't black screen on me. It's pretty clear that this card is basically one foot in the grave already. Its specs aren't the greatest, and its latest driver update was back in June 2022. But maybe, just maybe, there is still some gaming left to do on this card. Maybe, we just gotta find out in the benchmarks. With our standard Ryzen 5 3600 computer, let's see how it stacks up, shall we? Using 3DMark to show some synthetic benchmarks, it may or may not be surprised by the scores here. 3551 for FireMark isn't great, but isn't that bad either. TimeSpy is absolutely atrocious, however, at 881. So, long story short, 1440p is going to be out of the question beyond the most basic of games, and 1080p can be done, but it will really depend on the game, as we'll see later. The real thing to note here, however, is that these scores are actually lower than a GT 1030. Yeah, that is the kind of performance we're going to be expecting here. Not to mention that this is apparently on the higher end for these cards, at least reported by those with the same kind of setup. It's not looking too hot, but it was pretty funny to see both of these Steam achievements pop up at the same time at least. Starting us off with our classic benchmarking game, Black Mesa, while surprisingly easy to run normally for most cards, we actually had to take a bit of a visual downgrade here. Running at 900p low settings, we're hitting just around a 74 FPS average, with our lows once again obliterated by the loading screens. The last known values of 54 and 35 are decent, but not exactly accurate, since as we got deeper into Zen, it was common for our FPS to drop to the high 40s and low 50s at times. Overall, it's still decently playable and even looks alright with the lower visual fidelity, but expect the occasional slowdown within heavier scenes, especially the Zen overworld. Counter-Strike is really pushing the limits of the card here, and it's not looking too good. 1080p low preset with performance FSR enabled, we're barely hitting an above 60 FPS average here. The lows of 27 and 1 are indicative of the many random stutters you'll run into while playing, although they did seem to mellow out after a while. In an interesting case here, our settings are so low that even smoke and molotovs are not doing anything to change the frame rate significantly. Being heavily optimistic here, it's borderline playable, but it's not really a good experience and should be avoided by any means. It's not all doom and gloom for multiplayer action, however, as Deep Rock Galactic still manages to be super playable without needing to rely on something like FSR. 1080p low nets us a very nice 126 FPS average, although the lows of 49 and 26 shows the instability in our frame times. While they can go back and forth quite a bit, it shouldn't hamper your experience in mining Morkite too terribly. It's always interesting to see just how playable Deep Rock Galactic is on cards that are much older than it. Overall, it's playable and you should be able to put in quite a few hours within the mines. Fortnite is definitely showing off just how good performance mode can be for these lower end cards. As with 1080p, a mixture of high and medium settings, and performance mode enabled, we saw a pretty decent 82 FPS average, although the lows of 41 and 9 are not that great in retrospect. The inconsistent frame times, just depending on where you look, can easily throw you off your game and get you eliminated. While lowering the settings even more may help, you'll be better off picking a better card here, especially one that might actually get modern drivers, as these ones are going to be pretty out of date. Optimistically, it's playable, although very much not recommended by any means. Alan Wake proved to be pretty challenging for a card to run here, as to get a mostly stable 60 FPS, we've had to take a small resolution sacrifice. Trying out 900p low settings, we got a respectable 67 average here, with good lows of 48 and 34. While it was pretty frequent for us to drop down into the 50s and, at sometimes 30s, it was still a pretty smooth experience throughout. At the very least, combat was not hindered in any way. Considering the Steam release dropped a few months before this version of the card, I kind of expected it to run a bit better here, but this was a decently priced mid-range card for the time, so I can't really fault it all that much. Alan Wake is also pretty intensive with its lighting effects, as it is. Shadow of Mordor is more than capable of pushing this card to its limits, but at the very least, it still looks pretty decent even with the resolution drop. 972p low preset, we're hitting just under 60 FPS, with okay-ish frame times of 37 and 23. While the frame times could fluctuate pretty wildly during an intensive fight, it didn't hamper the experience to the point of unplayability. I was able to dispatch several orcs and two commanders with decent ease, although this was very much into the early game. While a further resolution drop can definitely help in terms of frame time stability, you could indeed play the game with these settings and have an okay time. Halo fans will be happy to know that the Master Chief Collection works pretty well overall. Running at 1080p original settings, we got a solid 76 for our averages here, with good lows of 49 and 40. Those point lows were pretty hard to spot overall though, as it felt very smooth throughout my time playing the Reach campaign. For a game collection that was released 7 years after this card dropped, this is a pretty respectable figure and shows just how optimized the game really is. On the indie side of things, you can play a pretty good amount of them, even on a 13-year-old card like this one. Dread Delusion is running perfectly fine here, with 102 FPS average and 63 and 8 for the lows. Playing the intro tutorial and hunting down Vella, I had zero complaints, although turning on V-Sync will probably help out smooth those frame times a bit overall. You may come across a small stutter or two, but otherwise, this game isn't too hard to run. It's pretty low poly after all, even if it is stylized. While Vintage Story may look deceivingly simple, its various settings can actually be pretty taxing on an old GPU like this one. Running at 1080p low preset, we just managed to get an over 60 FPS average, but as our percentile lows of 23 and 19 show, we can definitely see a bit of slowdown. It was pretty common to see us dropping down around 45 FPS when exploring, but overall this was still pretty playable. We still actually have quite a few settings to tweak still if we want to see some more stable frame times, but considering this is almost a 13-year-old GPU, I'd say it's handling itself pretty gracefully, all things considered. It was a noble attempt, but No Man's Sky is just too much for our 7770 to handle. Running at 720p original settings with ultra performance FSR, we couldn't even reach a 30 FPS average, even if the lows are pretty decent comparatively. Maybe if we were playing on a tiny screen it could work, but overall, it's just a complete visual sludge or a pretty unplayable frame rate. If you are looking to play that new update, this card is not going to be the one for you. So, I knew this wasn't going to be pretty, and it very much was not so. Cyberpunk was never going to properly run on a card like this, but I decided to see just how far we could go for a playable frame rate. Playable in quotation marks. So, dropping down to 768p, with the lowest the settings could go, with FSR3 enabled to performance and frame generation on, we got ourselves 37 FPS average, with lows of 15 and 13. Is it usable? Not at all. Not only does the screen get smushed down so you're playing on a small window, but also the input lag is absolutely atrocious. I never really measured it, but it felt about a half second delay. My camera would definitely still be in motion, even if my mouse wasn't moving, if that makes sense. It was worth a shot, but clearly, just stay away. Overall, I will absolutely commend the card for being able to still decently be usable after nearly 13 years. Playing with it should be mostly reserved for those older games and indie titles, because anything decently modern would just absolutely destroy your retinas. However, there is one major thing kind of holding this card back from being a sensible purchase, at least in my opinion, and I kind of mentioned it before, the GT 1030. As surprising as it may be, the GT 1030 can really trade blows with the 7770, and because it is a more modern card, means it has more up-to-date drivers. The only thing that, yes, the GT 1030 is on average a bit more expensive, anywhere from $50 to $70 on Amazon and eBay, while the 7770 can be had for about $25 to $40. The price to performance will be a bit skewed, but the 1030 will indeed last you a bit longer, especially if you're going to be forced to use Windows 11. You could also argue that for that kind of money, you can also buy something like a secondhand GTX 1060, which will handily beat out both cards and will still get modern drivers. It's just kind of whatever fits your need and your budget at that time. If you've only got the money for a 7770 or you already have one, you can still get some gaming done. I would like to thank you all for watching. If you like what you saw, feel free to check out the other various reviews I have on my channel. Be sure to stay tuned as I still have even more in the works. I wish you all a good day, and I will be sure to see you all next time. Until then.